Now, a 2017 report, which was published in 2019 by the National Crime Research Bureau, says that there is an alarming increase in the registered crime against women. Now, what does this mean? It says that on an average, around 1,000 crimes are registered every day, which makes it 3.5 lakh in a year. Out of this, 93 women are victims of rape every day, which is among one third of them are minors. Around 87,924 women registered cases of sexual harassment, which is around 241 a day.
All these laws have to percolate down, for which we need to have a lot of awareness programs.
Teaching them about good and bad touch, teaching them sex education, making them aware of the power of no.
We teach girls, like, you know, pepper spray and self-defense. Why can't we teach the boys how to be boys and how to respect?
I would think that self-defense should be taught to every child, every male and female child, and definitely to the female child.
Hello and welcome to this very special episode that we are going to be talking about women's safety. Now, what a horrific situation are we in? It troubles each one of us, not just because we've had in Hyderabad, we've had in Unnao, or we've had a minor in Tonk, but it's because each of these happen way too frequently now. I'm joined by this august panel here of women from different backgrounds who are going to get into this discussion with me to try and understand what is the future that we are landing ourselves in. And Shruti, my first question to you, you've been working a lot with women in a particular strata of the society. Now, these are women who may not have got the kind of education, may not have been empowered to go out and work, and you're actually getting them to do that. What have been your experiences on this?
So like you said, actually, many of them don't have the same opportunities as do the men, but they're highly talented, they're equally skilled, sometimes more skilled than the men. What we've realized is the moment you give them the opportunity to work and the moment they get some income in their hand, the entire dynamic of the family changes. Like, we have noticed that, you know, earlier, like, girls were not allowed to go and sell. They would be probably locked up inside their homes. And then some of these girls would run away. Just changing the economics of the can change the entire dynamic of how the family unit sees the woman. And there she then becomes a decision maker for her children and for the society at large.
Now, here are people in the corporate, women who are empowered, who are independent. Yet we have a lot of cases that you have Posh, which is just so, you know, so required. What has been your experience and what does Posh actually mean?
So POSH, it stands for the Prevention of Sexual Harassment, and the objective of this committee and the way it was, the constitution has implemented it, is to really provide safety and security to women in a working environment. Right. And if you have more than 10 employees in an organization, that even the smallest company is supposed to have this committee. Right. The objective is prevention, prohibition, and redressal. So there is a committee which is called the Internal Complaints Committee, ICC, wherein women can go and lodge their complaint. If they cannot do it themselves, they can take the help of a colleague, relative, friend, anybody who can help them articulate the concern, you know, the problem. And the committee is supposed to hear from both sides and provide resolution within 3 months.
For example, the Unnao case, right? That lady was going to testify and she had no police protection. How do women in the last rung of the society even come to know what their rights are?
See, I think the biggest thing is we have laws in India, but they are not percolating down. I mean, we are talking about villages, we are talking about the uneducated strata, but how many women even in the metropolitans here today know exactly what our rights are or what are the laws which are there to protect us? And then are these laws being backed up? Like, you know, when she spoke about POSH. Now, if you speak to a lot of other people or, you know, the HR people also, what is the follow-up? Similarly, when you talk about the Unnao case, now she was entitled to a witness protection, but she should have been told. either by the police or by the court or her investigating officer. Because in 2018, the Supreme Court has held up the draft witness protection program. And though it has not been legislated upon, but the draft the Supreme Court has instructed has to be supported by every state. But somebody should have told her, then she would have been asked to make an application and the protection could have been granted.
I think is just that, it's just the way every woman knows about what is the remuneration when she joins, right? This should be sent out along with it almost, you know. And the helplines have to be far more visible, because right now there are so many laws and so many you know, things in place, but nobody really knows about it. So POSH specifically is covering the entire working environment. Yes, so there would be different laws for women in general, which Anju would be able to talk about, but this is to protect the interests, to encourage women to work.
And now what do we do about the women of the group, about every other Indian who is out there?
Let's go back to the basics of first is education. You know, at the school level, at the family level, this value has to be instilled on, you know, respecting women and respect, and, you know, teaching them about good and bad touch, teaching them sex education, making them aware of the power of no, what it means. Simple things like that. I mean, I think boys and girls both need to know about it. Boys need to know how to respect girls. Girls need to know they need to respect themselves.
What Shruti was saying is so right, and I think, you know, like when we do workshops, especially if you're dealing with a little older students, I think it's also important to talk to them about the laws and pick up a few cases for them to understand. Because when I interact with, you know, teenagers or something, when you tell them about cyber places, you know, this happened, somehow they believe, you know, you don't get caught. So somewhere they believe that when we write about girls or somewhere, we're not going to get caught. And I think that is the perception they carry forward in life, that if I misbehave or if, you know, I assault, it's not going to really happen. In India, you really don't get to go behind bars. So that reality has to now been shared, and, you know, we don't have to protect our children. No, 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 don't tell them. We have to start telling them.
Also, it's always like the defensive attitude that we teach girls, like, you know, pepper spray and self-defense. Why can't we teach the boys how to be boys and how to respect, and the whole family culture of love and, you know, like respect the sisters and the mums and your girlfriends and treat women properly? I mean, it's so complex. I mean, we think that it is that kind of society, but in America, like we talked before, the women are so powerful. They are independent, they have money, and yet, you know, it's one of the biggest countries of violence, sexual violence. You know, they have the same issues everywhere, world over. It's the whole mindset. It's the whole mindset of that whole thing. And also, this, it's the media. I totally blame the media. You know, it's women are objects. And the whole boys will be boys, you know, men are macho, you know, we've got to be powerful.
How much of a role in all of this do you think Bollywood, specifically I'm talking about India, has to
play? I think it plays a big, big role. And, you know, if you look at our TV, the serials on TV, some of the comedy programs, everywhere the woman is actually the object on which the entire series of jokes and the fun happens. Even when the woman is an actor, you know, the jokes that she makes will be on her sexuality, on her dumbness, you know. So it is all targeted towards the woman as an object, and I think till the time that stops, and, you know, I think it's rape and murder are still, you know, going far, but it actually starts at a very basic level. When you start accepting that woman can be treated this way and can be talked to like that, then everything else becomes just one more step, you know. So I think it needs to be cut right at the bottom, wherein women cannot be treated like objects.
Are there any legal systems around it, or do you think we can have some legal systems around it?
See, actually, nowadays on web, you have so many websites which are telling you about the laws in a very easy way. Like if you go to the government website on women and children, you have every law stated there. And I mean, some tend to go by section, some tend to simplify it. It's very easily available. But again, with my experience, it's not just the law being there. It's about including it into every area of our lives. When you start talking to people in simplified terms, whether it's students, which I think is very right, when you start that early, they have to incorporate it that this is wrong. And this is not just wrong morally. It is also wrong legally. And we have to start speaking about it in all our spaces, including work. So now there's something, the laws are there, they exist on the web very easily, but are we practicing it? And what is the policing happening thereafter?
Absolutely. How do, in today's times, with all of this happening, whereas parents, each one of us, tell our children, specifically girl children, don't go out alone, be safe, I'd come with you, because of the things that are happening, how do we ensure that tomorrow we can still instill that kind of confidence and independence in them that unknowingly we are giving our male children?
Yeah, it's really tricky, because on one hand you want to tell them that you're independent and you're equal to the boy, you know, your friend who's a boy, and at the same time, while he can go out, you know, you can't. But the point is that today even boys are not safe, by the way, the kind of cases which come up. And I think it is a couple of things, as she was rightly saying, you know, it is the respect that she needs to have for herself. And which is why I would think that self-defense should be taught to every child, every male and female child, and definitely to the female child.
And you know, you have a huge population. You know, even though I'm an expat, India is my home. So, you know, I do a lot of help for the underprivileged, you know, and I've seen some fantastic, really amazing schools, amazing people. You need to survive. So all the other little things that we're trying to teach them become second nature. So I really don't know how to get through that, except through the media, through...
Yes, fast track course, of course. You know, like you had cases where you've had day-to-day hearing. Right. These cases do deserve fast track course, and you must have a day-to-day hearing, because it also protects the women, the children. When we have rapes of minors, when we work under the POXO laws, it's so harassing for the children and their parents to keep appearing in courts, you know. So they have to have separate courts, fast track courts, and it must really be done.
Absolutely. I think very clearly, very important points that are coming. Out, you know, and I think at a very basic level, of course, there is a law, a legal system that, as Anju pointed out, should be very known to the person right to the last rung of the society. It should be made so basic, awareness has to go up. And I think another very important part that the panel has come up with is the fact that education, let's move beyond the bookish education and right now also tell them that there is a whole lot of social studies that need to happen, a lot about moral sciences that need to be taught about how each one of us need to behave in this society.